I think the strategic circumstances in the Middle East today are getting more dangerous. I think even though the ISIS caliphate has all but fallen, that because of the strategy first adopted by the Obama administration of aiding the Baghdad government in substantial part, we aided others as well, the Kurds, parts of the Syrian opposition. At the end of the ISIS caliphate, unfortunately, the new shape of strategic reality in the Middle East is that Iran's influence has grown, and that it has created out of the ashes of the caliphate an arc of control stretching from its own territory through the Shia parts of Iraq controlled by the Baghdad government, linking up with the Assad regime in Syria and Hezbollah in Lebanon. We have reports just from last night that Israeli forces may have struck an Iranian base near Damascus, said to be a Syrian base, of course. But that's what's happened. The influence of Iran has grown as ISIS has been diminished. And that's a direct threat to Israel. It's a direct threat to America's Arab friends in the region. It is the beginning of the next struggle for hegemony geographically within the region between Iran and its surrogates on the one hand and the Sunni Arabs on the other. It's the struggle for hegemony within Islam that has gone on centuries between Shia and Sunni. And I think it's one of the causes for the nuclear arms race that we see underway in the Middle East today, prompted in large part by this devastatingly bad nuclear deal that the Obama administration signed with Iran in 2015. All of these problems are now coming to bear on the Trump administration just 1 year in office, but nonetheless, it's inherited decades worth of issues. And although it may seem like a long way from the Middle East, I just want to stress why the president's decision on North Korea's nuclear weapons program will be so important. Because we are now, I think, at the stage where diplomacy, certainly with North Korea, has completely run its course. I suspect, I worry, I fear that diplomacy with China has run its course. And North Korea's progress in both ballistic missiles and nuclear weapons has gotten to the point where analysts all across our political spectrum believe that it's only a very short period of time before North Korea will be able to hit any target at once in the continental United States. Now, you know, when President George W. Bush referred to an axis of evil in the world, it wasn't just a literary metaphor. Iran and North Korea have cooperated on these issues for many, many years. North Korea sold Iran its first Scud missiles 25 years ago. They have worked together on ballistic missile developments ever since then. And why not? Because their objectives were the same, to put nuclear weapons under the nose cones of these missiles. This was not to launch weather satellites or communication satellites. So over the years, I think what North Korea learned, what Iran learned, they shared together. And North Korea has simply demonstrated its the extent to which its program has made progress more than Iran has. I think there's every reason to believe there's cooperation on the nuclear side as well. After all, their uranium enrichment technology for both of them was acquired by AQ Khan, the Pakistani nuclear entrepreneur who stole the designs from Uranco, the European Uranium Enrichment Company. So their enrichment technologies have progressed together. AQ Khan sold them both their nuclear weapons designs, which he had stolen from Pakistan, which got them from China. We know that because another one of AQ Khan's customers was Libya. And when we got the Libyan nuclear weapons designs, they were written in Chinese. So that North Korea and Iran have a common enrichment technology, they have a common weapons design, and there's every reason to think that their cooperation on the nuclear front was demonstrated by the reactor in the Syrian desert that Israel destroyed in September of 2007. So we don't know, our intelligence in North Korea is particularly poor. we don't know how much of the Iranian program may be in North Korea. So when you hear all this talk about verification and compliance with the 2015 Iran nuclear deal, just remember North Korea was not a party to it for good reason, but that much of what Iran is doing could well be done in conjunction with Pyongyang. And even beyond that, any technology, nuclear or ballistic missile, that North Korea has today, Iran can have tomorrow by writing a large enough check. Let me just spell it out. You know, in Iran, you have a rich, eager buyer for this technology. In North Korea, you have a poor, eager seller. Anybody having any trouble with the shape of this transaction? That's why we should not be diverted by minutiae about the Iran nuclear deal. The threat posed by North Korea is a global threat. It will sell anything it has to anybody. Iran, ISIS, Al-Qaeda, if they had hard currency, any aspiring nuclear power. So that the threat posed by North Korea is not just to South Korea, Japan, and the United States. It's a global threat. The way President Trump decides to handle that is going to be critical for how we deal with Iran and what I think would be the complete crash of counterproliferation policy worldwide. It won't just be Iran and North Korea that end up with nuclear weapons. It's Saudi Arabia, Egypt, Turkey, and many, many others across the Middle East and beyond. So we're entering into a particularly dangerous period here for the administration, just 1 year into its tenure in office. And it's why people such as all of you in this room who care so much about Israel, about the U.S.-Israeli relationship, about the importance of strong national security policies to defend our innocent civilian populations against terrorists, whether they're suicide bombers or rogue states that seek to possess nuclear weapons. This is not the time to sit back. This is the time to redouble our efforts, because really, the future is in our hands. And the quality of the people in this room, I think, demonstrates why we have every reason to be hopeful if we stay strong and if we stay united. Thank you very much.